I do believe that we have with us the Speaker of the House, David Osborne, and Senate President Robert Stivers. Thank you, gentlemen, for making the quick jump from the House chamber to our Capitol Annex studios. Thank you so much. I'll begin with you, Senate President Stivers, your reaction to what you heard tonight.
Well, generally, budget addresses and Commonwealth, State of the Commonwealth addresses are always positive. You know, we don't want to rain on the parade tonight, but we're waiting to see, and the process starts. We had a good discussion tomorrow. I want to say something. You know, Sherman makes an interesting point because, yeah, we did think this budget was going to be a lot worse. But the reason it's not, and the reason we want to be very cautious, is that these numbers have been artificially inflated by billions and billions of borrowed money at the federal level being infused into our state economy. And that worries me. Yeah, are the numbers showing promise? Yeah, but why? And it's because of all this borrowed money and the increasing national debt that the federal government is taking on to stabilize states.
Speaker Osborne, is that a concern of yours as well about the source of this money and it could be just contributing to the overall deficit and the one-time monies?
It is disconcerting. I think that everybody acknowledges that we're in a better spot than we thought we would be financially with the revenues that we've taken in so far. But that doesn't make me any less nervous about where we may end up. And I think that you will see us take a very, very conservative approach, and we'll still have a very lean budget going forward. I think that the use of one-time monies is very disconcerting, especially on ongoing expenses. So, yeah, it does cause me some concern.
So, Mr. Speaker, did you hear anything in the governor's presentation tonight that you find some common ground with, you agree, and could be a good starting point to get the conversation going?
You know, I'm going to agree with Robert. It was an optimistic budget presentation. I think it was upbeat. I am certain that there are many, many areas that we will find common ground. I think that if you look at the working relationship that we have had on the budget in the past year with Rocky Atkins, with Budget Director Hicks, and other members of the administration, I am confident that we will find lots of common ground. Certainly, there are going to be some differences, and we will start. We actually started working on documents this morning. The governor released that information to us, so we could go ahead and get started working on it. And I'm sure that we will find some common ground, but there will certainly be some stark differences.
Can you tell us, Mr. Speaker, the process for our viewers who are curious about how things go? Many of our viewers know the process, but for those who don't, how does this go forward from this point on?
This is going to be a different process. So even those that kind of know the process, it's going to be a new process. We will actually have an Appropriations and Revenue Committee in the morning, where the budget director will present a more detailed version of the budget to the committee. And it is our hope that we can move this budget quickly, get it into conference. And I think that something that will be unlike past years is we will generally pass out of the House our version of the budget, which puts our stamp on what our priorities are, what we want the budget to look like. Then we send it to the Senate. They will do the same thing. And then we come together in conference to try to reach compromise on that. I think that the budget that you see come out of the House, as well as the one that comes back out of the Senate, is going to be essentially a continuation budget that is not indicative of what this budget is going to look like ultimately. It is simply a matter to expedite the process, knowing that we need to get this budget into conference. So I would caution everybody to read absolutely nothing into the budget that comes out first, because it will absolutely just be a continuation budget version of the budget, that is just an effort to expedite things so we can get to work immediately once we recess next week.
So, Senator Stivers, true point, and that's kind of how things typically go, right? That the House has a version, they send it to you, you have a version, and then there is a negotiating group who comes together to reconcile those differences. So that's the same process, just a little bit different because of the environment and the fact that you're doing this in an odd year session where you only have, what, 25 more working days.
Right, and when you say 25 working days, you're right, Renee, on that. And you know, I think you know, much to the chagrin of Amy and Sherman, we found out without lobbyists in the building last year, we got a lot of work done. So we hope to expedite the process to where we can use it, as the speaker has said, that process of our recess between our mandated reopening on the first Tuesday after the first Monday in February, that we'll have that ability and time to work through this in a collaborative nature, get more information, and get this process moving, because we are in a different situation and it's taken a lot of discussion and thought. But what comes out of this process this next week will not be anything close to what I think the final budget will be.
And so can you give us an idea of the schedule? Will you, because you can have some liberty, I do believe, some flexibility in how you adjust the calendar. So will the lawmakers be in session next week any to kind of expedite this process so that you can get to the negotiating table a little quicker as you have discussed? And perhaps maybe that's a question for the speaker as well.
We've already signed the memorandum altering the schedule for our legislature to meet because we wanted to see how the first few days went. I signed the memo. I don't know if it got to David, but yes, we're already ready to do that.
Okay. House Speaker David Osborne, can you elaborate any?
Yes, I don't know that I can say any more, really. We did sign the memo today that extends this or adjusts the calendar, extending this first portion of the session through Wednesday.
Okay. And so do you foresee having lots of conversations? We mentioned Rocky, former state representative and majority leader, Rocky Adkins. Do you foresee having lots of conversations with them during this cycle?
I do. Rocky is a vital part of this process. We have a great working relationship with him, always have. And he will be, along with Budget Director Hicks, who is an incredibly bright mind in the budget field. I'm sure that we will be in frequent contact.
Just a couple of the provisions, and then I'll let you all go because I know it's been a long day. The educator raises, the raises for state workers, of course, fully funding the pensions, more money for the Michelle P., the community supports program. Those things seem to be that's fertile ground to begin. Do you all agree somewhat with some of those ideas? And I'll start with you, President Stivers.
Well, again, it all depends on revenue sources, method and manner. That's everything sounds good until you put it in the context of sources, one-time dollars versus recurring dollars, you know, our debt service, our structural imbalances, our obligations, and what's being said by the respective pension systems. The governor said he was fully funding all the pension systems. We're putting close to $2.5 billion just in our pensions. If I'm not badly mistaken. So it's all in context. I can't say yes, I can't say no, but we'll start hearing about it tomorrow. And I'm going to have a little bit difference of opinion with the speaker. Yeah, Rocky's an integral part, but somewhere along the line, the governor's got to step in and have conversations. And you've heard me, you've heard the speaker, and you've heard others. The governor says he wants to work with us. Now's the time.
Speaker Osborne, I'll give you the last word, sir.
I would agree with that, with what Robert said. As far as raises go, certainly our teachers, our state employees are very deserving. But I think we also have to acknowledge that there are still tens of thousands of people that are out of work. There are tens of thousands of people waiting on the unemployment rolls for their claims to be processed. The relief fund for businesses, I'm sure that those businesses will welcome that money. But what they really want is they want their businesses back open. And I think we passed some measures today that begin that process. The people that are waiting to have their claims processed, to give them $1,000, again, I'm sure that they will be very appreciative of it. But we've spent $17 million, or the governor's office has spent $17 million with a private company trying to process these claims. Maybe we should just fix the problem and process the claims. That's what they would really like, in addition to having their jobs back. And again, I think that we've taken some steps today and this week, and we'll continue over the next few days to help rectify that.
Well, thank you, Speaker Osborne and Senate President Robert Stivers. I appreciate your time and your hard work and your commitment to the Commonwealth. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Renee.
Thank you, Renee.